So the first move we can make when trying to expand our educational imaginations is to shift from one school in the world to all the schools of the world and try to imagine what would happen as we slowly expanded our vision and our space from that one school to a situation where we took as our object of focus all the schools of the world and the patterns that they showed. And that will take our educational imaginations and expand it outwards into a situation where you can see with one breath, or in this case, one video, what the patternings are of education in the world as we currently know it today. So let's start off with one school. And I've taken the school, which is directly below the house that I'm staying in. And this is Carter High School. And what you can see is that it's an amazing school. I think you'll firstly notice the beautiful pool, which I occasionally swim in. You'll notice the expansive green grounds, the tennis courts, which are there for people to play on. You'll notice that the school itself has a whole number of cars sweetly parked with the teachers inside working. You can't really see it at the moment, but you don't really see any children wandering around. You'll notice as well that the school has tarred roads within it, which allow you access to the school all the way down to the swimming pool. You'll also see a big green building, which is a multi-purpose centre, where the kids can play basketball and do their various assorted sports when it's raining or when it's too hot. A fantastic school. And what you'll also notice is that the suburbs surrounding it kind of repeat a similar theme. You'll see that a lot of the houses have swimming pools, and that the roads are nicely tarred, and that the houses are fairly large and expansive. Now let's just shift from that one school and let's travel due west for a little while until we come across another school. We've gone outside the suburbs, we've got into a slightly more rural area, and suddenly we come across Mpanda High School. It's a very different situation. Firstly, notice that there's not much greenery around, not much shrubbery, no garden really to speak of. Notice that there's not really much of a fence. The roads within the school are not tarred. There's not many cars there. There's not many teachers there at this point in time. The school basically looks impoverished and is impoverished. It's a tough school to go to. If you had to look at the patterns during the day, you'd notice that unlike Carter High School, the kids come to the school over a longer period of time. Even after the bell is gone, there's still kids coming. You'll notice that around 10, 11, 12, there's children leaving, as there are teachers leaving, and the school itself would come to a halt at the end of the school day. Whereas at Carter High School, you'd see activities in the school all the way through until about 5 o'clock in the afternoon. But you'd also notice very regular times in terms of kids arriving at school and then no one to be seen outside the school premises until the school bell goes. Now, that picture of these two schools repeats itself on a world scale. And to imagine that, what I want you to do is I want to draw the biggest possible dividing line between the rich and the poor as it plays out in this beautiful but tragic world of ours. On a world level, what we see is we basically see a north-south line where you have the rich north, including Australia and New Zealand on the south on the one side, and you have a poor south. And it's distinct what actually goes on in these two zones. In the more economically developed countries, you have a high gross national product. You have low birth and death rates. And you can see this, for example, in this age sex pyramid, where in the northern countries, the more developed countries, you have Lots of old people who living to a healthy and happy old age with their pensions hopefully protected, and you have a low birth rate. Whereas in the less economically developed countries, you have a really large proportion of children, and because of a high death rate, you only have a few old people. And this plays out in all sorts of ways in education. You'd notice, for example, that in terms of employment in the north, most people are employed in the tertiary sector, whereas in the poorer south, most people are employed in primary kinds of employment, which isn't that well paid. So what you can see is the situation which played out between Carter and Mpande plays out at a world level in terms of the division between north and south and the schools that it actually has. And let's now narrow the focus to a space between individual schools and the world picture, and let's shift down into South Africa as a whole. And what you'll notice in South Africa, firstly, is that the same situation between rich and poor plays out. You've got Gauteng or Johannesburg, where people are earning more than $10,000, and you've got Cape Town, where people are also earning more than $10,000. And you'll notice that between the Western Cape and Gauteng, you have very wealthy areas, and then you have increasingly poor areas, with the Eastern Cape being very poor, as well as to some extent the Northern Province and KwaZulu-Natal. Now, the key question you have to ask yourself when using your educational imagination at this point is to say, well, how do these differences in wealth and income play out in education? And to do that, let's create a simple graph. And on the graph, what we have is we have x-axis, and on that x-axis, we have the student's socioeconomic background. And that's the key vital indicator, which goes from very poor minus 100 to very rich plus 140. And what we'd expect is we'd expect a situation where on the y-axis, which is the student reading score, we'd expect those that are richer and wealthier to do better on the student reading scores. That just comes with the fact that better schools are bought. Family structures have situations where the mother can stay at home, she's well educated, she can educate the kids. Whereas in poorer environments, the kids are struggling, the parents are struggling to hold jobs down, and in general, you'd expect a poorer school structure and therefore poorer student reading scores. Now, in an ideal world, what would we hope for? Well, we would hope for a situation where whether you were rich or poor, you kind of did the same in terms of your reading score. So you'd hope for what I'd call a flat line, sitting at the 640 mark, where whether you're rich or poor, you do well in education. But we know from research that that really isn't the picture. In general, you tend to have a sadder situation where you have a steep line where the poor do badly and the rich do well in terms of their reading scores. And in education and development, what you can hope for is you can hope for a situation where you try and flatten the line, where you try and improve the performance of the poor learners, and at the same time as that, you try and reduce the radical economic gap between rich and poor. Now, that's something which is a struggle which is bigger than education, but which education can play a part. So let's take a look at how this plays out at a provincial level in South Africa. And what you'll notice is that the Western Cape and Gauteng both have the richest students and the highest scores. But some of the more interesting spaces which I'd like to point to you in terms of the provincial picture is KwaZulu-Natal. Now, KwaZulu-Natal has a province where you've got rich areas like Durban and then very poor rural areas, unlike Nkandla, if we just take the homestead. The surrounds of Nkandla certainly are poor. And what we have is we have a situation where the poorest students do really badly. Minus 60 in terms of socioeconomic background means that you're scoring at around 480 in terms of your reading. And the richer you get in KwaZulu-Natal, the better your score is. And that's a tragic situation which speaks to students who have no control over where they're born being condemned to a poor education, and kids who had no control of being born into a rich family doing well in education. Now, I'd also like to point to Northwest in the story. You'll notice Northwest right at the bottom. And you'll see that there you do have a flat line. Okay, all the students are really poor and they're all doing equally well. Now, I say well, but I'm actually putting that in inverted commas, because actually what's happening is they're doing equally badly. It doesn't really matter where you are in the Northwest schools. If you're within those rural schools or in the peri-urban areas, you are going to be doing really badly. And it's in those areas where we need to address what's going on with schooling. And we're taking a look at it at the moment. But what I'm trying to point to you is the situation where you get variations as you travel, as your mind kind of works through space, expanding from one school where I'm located, slowly but surely outwards to the schools in my area, to the schools in my province, to the schools in my country, and how that plays out in terms of performance and socioeconomic levels. And we can now do the same thing, but instead of working at a country level, we can start to work how different countries actually operate. And to do that, let's expand from South Africa, which are the Southern and Eastern African countries. And there we find another picture, which is really interesting. And what you'll see firstly with South Africa is that there is massive differences between students who are poor and students who are rich in terms of their performance in education. But of more interest than that is the fact that our richest students, who are sitting at around the 120 socioeconomic level and are getting around about 520 on their reading scores, are performing at the same level as the poorer students, far poorer students in Tanzania, Mozambique, Kenya, Swaziland and Botswana. Now that says something very interesting. It says that it's not only your socioeconomic conditions that determine how well you do at school. There are other countries who are poorer than South Africa who are doing a better job in primary school in terms of education for their poor kids. And that should be a wake-up call to South Africa, because you cannot use the simple excuse that you haven't got enough resources, that you're not being given enough for education to happen, when other countries are more poor than South Africa, but doing better in terms of their performance. So it's a massive wake-up call. But you do have to be careful when taking these figures into account, because, for example, at this level, we are focusing really on the performance within the primary school sector, not performance at high school and at university as well. And in South Africa, we have a situation where we are trying to get as many kids as we can through the whole system, all the way from grade RR through to university or FET level. And that same point cannot be said about Tanzania, Kenya, Mozambique, and Botswana and Swaziland, where you do not have an extensive carry through all the way through the system. In those schools, what you see is you start to see a dramatic dropout rate when you get beyond the primary school. So what happens if we expand now from our focus from one school compared to another school nearby, to the schools of the different provinces and how they compare with each other, to the schools of the different countries located in the southern and eastern African region, and we expand outwards even further into bigger regional areas. Now, what we have here is we have an indication of the attempt to get our kids educated. And this is a wonderful graph which catches how many kids are out of school, how many kids are not getting schooling. And the comparison is between the world in 1990 and the world in 2010. It's the job we've done in the last 20 years to get kids into school. Now notice that there are three divisions here. You've got the rest of the world on the one side, then you've got South and West Asia, which contains a massive amount of the unschooled. And at the same time as that, you've also got Sub-Saharan Africa, which currently has the most unschooled kids in the world. Now, what's dramatic about this picture is you'll notice the difference between South and West Asia, which had a massive amount of uneducated young girls, 25.6 million. And in the 20 years, there's been a successful reduction of that to 7.3 million girls who are currently not at school. Now, that's an astonishing achievement. Something similar has happened with boys, but not to the same extent. Now, we do not see the same pattern happening in Sub-Saharan Africa. In fact, in our own continent, we are seriously struggling to get our kids educated. In 1990, there were 20 million girls not in school. We've managed to get that down by 4 million to 16, to around 16 million. Now, that is an achievement. Let's make no mistake about that. And it's caused massive differences in the way, in the patterns of how primary school enrollment is working. But still, in comparison to Southwest Asia, we see that we are falling behind in the attempt to get education for all. But notice that when we try and talk about the enrollment figures, we have substantially different patterns of how enrollment happens. Now, what I'd like to talk to firstly is I'd like to talk to a fairly ideal pattern, and that is the black line. And what you'll see with the black line is you'll see you've got a situation where you've got a grade-specific enrollment rate, which goes from grade 1 through to grade 2, 3, 4, all the way through to grade 12. Now, the most ideal situation would be a situation where you have around 100% of the kids of that age group enrolling in school, and by the end of grade 12, around 100% still in school. That would be the best possible line. But if you do have a situation in developing countries where you're sitting just above 100% enrollment and that holds a steady line all the way through the grades, where by grade 12 you still have over 50% of the kids in school, that's a very healthy enrollment and keeping kids in school rate from primary to lower secondary to upper secondary school. But unfortunately, that is not the predominant pattern being shown, as we've put massive pressure on schools to enroll more and more kids into primary school due to things like the Education for All initiative. What we now see is a situation where you have a massive initial enrollment rate. Now, the massive initial enrollment rate, or the kids in grade one, is because we're trying to get more and more kids into school. But it also has to do with the fact that when the kids get into grade one, they don't actually know what's going on, and they have to repeat grade one again and again and again, which results in an initial massive amount of kids doing grade one and grade two. But what you'll notice is because the system is overstressed and cannot perform with that amount of kids, there's a massive dropout rate. And that dropout rate by grade 6 has already dropped all the way down to below a 50% enrollment of the kids of that age, and then eventually dropping by grade 12 to almost nothing. And that's a tragic situation in the world at the moment in developing countries with the pressure to try and get more and more kids in school. It's meant that developing countries' educational systems at the primary level have got overstressed, and there's a massive dropout rate, which is tragic. Now, if that gives us a picture of the enrollment rates and the throughput rates within schooling itself, it doesn't give us a bigger picture if we had to step back and say, well, what about how schooling happens all the way from primary school through to universities, through to the tertiary level? And what about the difference between, on the one side, males, and on the other side, females? Well, here is South Africa in the year 2000. And what you'll notice firstly is you've got the males on the left and the females on the right. And that big red middle line has to do with the fact that we have a lot of people at the year 2000 who have got no education whatsoever. And then a substantial majority of people really only have primary education. But it's still a tragic picture where hardly any of our population has got a tertiary education. And most of those people, by the way, who do have the tertiary education are white. And here's now the projected figure of what this is going to look like by 2050 if we carry on with the current projected trends in South African education. And what we notice firstly is that red center line is gone. We are educating our kids. Number two, you'll notice that although there's a fair set of people who are in the yellow sector with primary education, the biggest majority by far are the people getting a full education all the way through to the end of high school. Now, this is a major achievement in South Africa. But even more important than that is the fact that we've got a very productive tertiary sector, which is playing an increasing role in South African education, especially not only with the universities, but you're going to find with the technicons and the further education and training centers. And what's happening is the amount of people who are getting a tertiary education is growing all the time. And by 2050, we will, in South Africa, have a dramatic increase in those people who've got tertiary education, especially notice amongst the women. And that is another fantastic achievement in terms of the way that South African education is working. Although we have to be very careful about forgetting about the men in our world. We certainly don't want a radicalized, uneducated male population running about with nothing to do. I can think of nothing more tragic for South Africa than that kind of a situation. So, what we've done is in this brief first video, is we've taken you on a wild journey from one school to all the schools of the world. And we've taken a look at patterns that can be shown between the rich and the poor on the one side, and how this plays out in terms of primary education, secondary education, tertiary education in the world as a whole. And the hope is that by doing this, we start the process of expanding your educational imaginations.